I thank you, Father, for letting us, giving us the privilege of being sung over by you. Thank you for the fresh reminder that you delight yourself in us. Thank you for the anchor of our soul. Thank you that we need not worry. If you're for us, who can be against us? We thank you for songs like that, that as we immerse ourselves in the ocean wave of your Spirit that pours over us as we sing, we're mindful that you are much stronger than any situation that this world may bring. And so we thank you for that reminder, and we pray that by your Spirit you will help us to hold on to that reality as we not only listen to this message, but go forth into the rest of the week, or the new week, I should say. Help us to realize that you are a God that is always with us. That same power and love that we experience singing this song goes with us no matter where we go. And we thank you for that reality. Lord, I pray that you'll help me to deliver your message. We ask for your blessing upon those tremendous men of God that will step forth to their pulpit at the churches in our community tomorrow morning, and are absolutely relying on you to help them to deliver your message. So very little messenger, much to do about the message. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen. All right. Well, I need to have a drink because all this yelling and screaming is parched me. So I'm going to try Old Faithful here. And we've already put Frank to sleep. I mean, that was quick. That was, okay. I appreciate that. All right, when you snore, we're going to, do you give us permission to throw things at you? All right, throw tissues. Okay, all right. Love you. So we're going to start a new message series tonight, and it is called A Healthy Body. And that doesn't necessarily mean your physique. I'm not one to model that. I'm well, yeah, don't lie in church. I'll explain the reason for this series as we go along. But if you would, get your hands on a copy of God's Word. And there's plenty of them here. There's some blue ones on the seats. As I go through the message this evening, frequently you'll see verses that I mention, and the verse that we will read together will be up on the screen. Now, when I say that, it means that the page number for these blue Bibles will be up on the screen. Our assumption that we've made here is that if you have your own Bible, you know how to navigate through it. But if you don't, we'll help you with a page number so you can read the scripture. And I just really want to tell you, even though I've studied and researched and due diligence and all that kind of good stuff, I am far from Jesus. I am far from the author of the Word of God. And woe to you if you don't put your eyes on God's Word and make sure that what I'm telling you is the truth. If we're going to build our lives on this Jesus, then it needs to be His Word, not mine. Okay? And painfully aware of the task that God has given me as a pastor to equip God's people to do God's work. And so I pray that God will allow us that grace tonight through something that I would say, you know. As we get into this thing, I would just want to tell you that it was about 4 years ago that I was sitting in my living room. I have a recliner. Mine's comfortable. And, right, Dan? And I got to be careful when I say that because I don't remember who gave us that. That chair's awesome. And so I was sitting on my recliner one day, and I said to my wife, she was in the bathroom taking a bath, and I yelled across the house, and I said, honey, can you turn me down just a hair, Josh? I said, honey, why do we have this? And she didn't know what I was talking about. I mean, see, she thinks I know what she's talking about when she does that from the other side of the house. But the guys, we are, right? You have no idea, right? Well, so, but she asked me, what are you talking about? And I said, the TV. And she says, I don't know. And I said, well, like, we never watch this thing. Why are we paying for cable? So, but let me just tell you something. I don't know what you pay for cable. Like, so this is a soapbox moment. It's not the Bible. I don't know what you pay for cable. What's it? I haven't had cable in 4 years. What's basic cable cost? How much? $50? $89. $82. Yeah. How much is when you go nuts and get like all the football and all that? You're like, woo! Big time, right? $300 a month. Okay, so let's just cut that in half. Let's just cut that in half, right? Let's just say it was $150 a month across the board average, right? Is that a stretch? It's not a stretch, is it? 4 years. I could give you a check right now for $7,200 right now. 4 years, right? Now think about, this has nothing to really do with the message, but I was thinking about this as I was introing in. I was like, man, just think of how much you could help people. You know what I'm saying? Like how you could be more generous. You could help people just from that alone. $7,200, no cable. Awesome. But anyway, we don't have cable, and I'm thankful because I have been able to, with very little that we would have, and be able to maybe some help some folks, and that's good. But here's the thing with the cable. Like I yelled out, "We don't use this thing," but there was sometimes that I did. You see? See, sometimes, and it was only on the weekend, and what would happen is this was my drift. See, this is what I would do. See if it looks familiar. Saturday and Sunday. You guys are a good looking crowd from here, man. Tell me if you're looking in the mirror. Come on now. Someone's got to be lying up in here. One guy. That's why he's an elder, because he told the truth right there. Right? Saturday and Sunday. Brain dead coma. And it was six letters. For me, I don't know about you guys, it was PGA, and heaven forbid there was a major on, don't talk to me, or NFL, come on now, ladies, that was your chance right there. It wasn't, for some of us it might be FLW, but I tell you one thing, it wasn't WIFE, and it wasn't KIDS, and it wasn't GOD. It was, are you ready for some football? That was just me. That was my drift. That was my drift. So like I had to get rid of the TV. Because it's not a priority in my life. I realize that not one single play, not one single shot, not one single green jacket ever helped me. Might have helped Tiger. Didn't help me. Listen, I've been into golf my whole life and I've yet to get a purse check. Never. I've never gotten one. But you'd think I would have relied on that income the way I watched all day long. That was my drift. That was just my natural progression. This is what happened to me, right? Anyone? And so here's the thing. Let me ask you a question. What happens to an addict that, and it's time, listen, if you don't agree with me, you can disagree if you want, but I'm telling you, I know. Because I've visited many of us in jail. What happens to the addict of any sort that does not stay steady on AA, NA, CR, some recovery program? What happens to them? They drift, don't they? They're over here, everything's going good, and then all of a sudden they find themselves over here in a ditch somewhere. What in the world happened? You know what? You didn't stick with it. That's the problem. That's the problem. And listen, I'm kind of putting the two together, but it's the same thing. I know my drift. I know what I naturally will do. And so I have to cut the snake's head off, or I will find myself in that chair weekend after weekend after weekend, leaving my wife to go find something to do to entertain herself, when all the while the man who stood at the altar and said, I will be with you forever and I will be all that you need, I have neglected her and I sat in this stupid chair. That's what happens. That's what happens. So is it a wonder, now talking spiritually, is it a wonder why that Paul would tell us in Colossians 2:6, and now, just as you accepted Christ as your Lord, you must continue to follow him? Right? Makes sense, right? Does anyone remember the day they got saved? It was awesome, right? Like the weight of the world came off your shoulders. You realize how amazing Jesus is, and you realize how wretched you were and you couldn't fix it, and you ran to this Jesus that someone told you about and he saved you for all eternity. You're like, yes! I've seen that happen in this church. Seriously, this is not a big old church, right? I've had the joy of seeing that happen to over 200 people here, baptizing them and everything. Where are they at? I keep visiting them in jail. I keep hearing about their divorce on Facebook. I hear about the addictions. Wham! Crash. The same guy, Paul, would tell us in Romans 12:11, never be lazy, but work hard and let the Spirit excite you as you serve the Lord. I love that verse, and no one ever talks about it. It's the ongoing ministry of the Holy Spirit. See, everybody's talking about all the gifts of the Spirit and tongues and prophecy and healings and all this, raising him from the dead. It's awesome. God can do that stuff. But how about this? Let the Spirit excite you to create. As you step in and pursue him more and serve him more, he excites you more and more and more. He's invigorating your spirit and makes you have a greater zeal to serve the Lord and love the Lord and tell people about the Lord. The more you do it, the more you get. Snowball. I love this. One of my favorite verses in all of Scripture, Hebrews 11:6, that God is a rewarder of those who earnestly, say earnestly, earnestly seek him. He's a rewarder of those who earnestly seek him. He doesn't reward the ones who step in on occasion. So we're talking about a healthy body, right? I want to be healthy. So keeping this in mind, these verses that God speaks to you, why does the believer have to, why does he have to get at this Jesus full tilt? Kick the tires and light the fires, Big Daddy, right? Let's go. Let's get at this thing. Why does the Bible tell us time and time again like this? Just as you came to him, so follow him. He's a rewarder of those who earnestly seek him. Let him excite you as you serve. Come after this thing. Give yourself wholeheartedly to the Lord and you'll find him. Why does he keep saying all this? Why? See, it's a simple answer, and it's so evident. It's so evident. Because if you don't go at it, pursue him like crazy, that's where you end up. You drift. You drift. That's just the way we are. And no one is excluded from this. No one. A soul unattended will always drift toward sin. That's our bent. That's just the way we are. And listen, the only way to get better is to recognize the problem. You can't fix a problem that you're not aware of. You can't expect someone who thinks that their life is rocking it and perfect and go up to them and say, hey, I have a better way for you. Get away from me, punk. I'm making 300 large and driving a Benz. Step off with your Buick, dude. That's the way people are. You have to realize that there's a problem so that you can fix it. And the problem is if you don't stay at this Jesus full tilt, you're going down, you're going to drift. Every single one of us, that's exactly what happens. It's exactly what happens. I know this to be true personally. Two reasons. Experience. Anyone else with me? But you get, I mean, seriously, right? I mean, okay, so I got a microphone on, so you think that I'm sitting there reading the Bible all day? No. I don't. I should, but I don't. And there's seasons in my life where I haven't really been pursuing the Lord with all that I have. I'm not reading the scriptures like I should. It says to meditate on it day and night. I'm not doing that. And all of a sudden, my vocabulary becomes a little sharper, right? My attitude, my temper, come on now, gets a little bit shorter. Christians now. I'm not talking about if you don't even know Jesus from a hole in the wall. Go crazy all you want. But I'm talking about the believers. And you stop coming to church so often, and you stop, you lay the Bible down, you read it on occasion, and you don't, you stop giving, you stop serving, and you stop helping, and you stop praying, and you stop doing all those things, and all of a sudden you just notice, like, you're not getting along with your wife as much, or your husband as much, and your kids are on your nerves more, and you, once you don't go to church, you don't want to go to church, because it starts to form a habit, and boom, you're in the seat again. I mean, we've all done it. Like, no one is excluded from it, right? No one. Isn't it awesome when God's word just proves itself right again and again and again? Let me show you what I'm talking about. We all just agreed and experienced that that's the case, right? I just want to help you have confidence in God's word. God would tell us, the Apostle Paul would tell us, God would tell us through Paul in Galatians chapter 5. Do me a favor and go there for a moment. I want you to put your eyes on God's word. You don't want to take my word for it. Look what he says. Galatians chapter 5, verses 16, 17, and 19. And I want to give you a moment to get there. Galatians about three quarters of the way through the Bible. It's towards the end. It's in the New Testament. One of the letters that this apostle Paul wrote long, long time ago, Galatians chapter 5, 16 and 17. Are you guys there? Okay. If you're not, I apologize. I'm going to move forward. So this is what it says. So I say, Paul says, let the Holy Spirit guide your lives. Then you won't be doing what your sinful nature craves. The sinful nature wants to do evil, which is just the opposite of what the Spirit wants. And the Spirit gives us desires that are the opposite of what the sinful nature desires. Listen, these two forces are constantly fighting at each other. So you are not free to carry out your good intentions. Not to say that you can't make a good choice, but it's not just going to happen automatically. God's telling you this. Okay? Now, look at verse 19. See, when you follow the desires of your sinful nature, the results are very clear. And there's this list. Sexual immorality, and that could be a whole slew of different things. Pornography, messing around, doing stuff you shouldn't be doing, you know, whatever. Hostility, quarreling, jealousy, outbursts of anger, selfish ambition, dissension, division, envy, drunkenness, wild parties, and sins like these. So my claim was that if you don't tend to your soul, you're going to drift, right? Isn't that what I said? And what this is telling us here is that the sinful nature. Listen to the words it said. It said it wants, it desires, and it craves some things. It craves, like, just like, if you like something's one thing, but what if you like craving it? Like, it's down deep in your guts. I gotta have. That's the sinful nature at battle in you. It wants some things, it desires some things, and they're evil. And how many casualties could be avoided in the Christian church if we would recognize the truth of what God's trying to tell you about going after him full time so that you can avoid this? He. If we sing that he loves, we have to realize that if you love somebody, you don't want to see them drift off and fall, right? Do you want your kids to fall apart? Do you want your spouse to fall apart? So do you want you to fall apart? And how many casualties we could avoid if we would just go after him full time? See, there's these default sins that we just keep going to. That was mine. And I can't just say, well, honey, I'm going to, New Year's resolution, I'm not going to watch football. Yeah, exactly. That was wisdom right there. Honey, I'm not going to watch the Masters. Seriously. I'm sitting here with a needle in my arm. I'm just not going to do this anymore. I mean, come on, right? You got to take some action. You got to get at this thing full time, or you're going to crash. So listen. Don't think. Also, here's one that you might fall for. Don't think just because you know you're sitting in this church building right now. No, not me. See, it's not a church problem. It's a person problem. It's a people problem. It's a you, me problem. It's personal. And the thing is that it's magnified now where people gather. See, if you got a person with a problem and a person with a problem, right? My problem's bad. His problem's bad. But when you put them together, it's double bad, right? Let's triple it. Let's quadruple it. So it gets worse, and it's magnified where people gather, i.e. church. Here it is. And so the whole thing here with this series is we want to learn how to be a healthy body, us. I've been here with you guys for 5 years now, and I don't know what it is. Like, I don't want to let the calendar like mess with me. But I'm excited about 2016. I don't know what it is. Sometimes what you believe and you hope for, and the reality before your eyes, they're not congruent at all, right? Right? The things we hope for and the stuff that's going on, like, way out there. But isn't it sweet when what you believe and what you see start to become the same? That's good times, right? And I'm starting to see that. I'm starting to see something in this body and in this community that is very pleasing to my soul. And I think, I think God is at work in our community. I really honestly do. And I'm excited about it. And I think that 2016 for this church, I think the task that God has placed on this church is for us, listen up, for us to become a healthy body of Christ. So before you go there, you gotta take care of here, right? You gotta take care of here. And I think that's, I can just sense something happening here. I don't know what it is, but it's coming together. It's coming together. And I can't put my finger on it, but it's coming together. And I don't know if I'm alone in that, but I don't think that I am. So this issue is a single problem. It's also, of course, when you group us together, it's a body of Christ issue. But first, before we could talk about us and we got to talk about, you know, me and me individually. You got to be healthy before you can be part of a healthy body, right? So let's talk about this personal thing here, just to see if God really wants that for us. Romans 12, 1 says to give your bodies, give your entire body to God. 1 Corinthians 6, 19 says, don't you know that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit who lives in you and was given to you by God? You do not belong to yourself, for God bought you at a price, at a high price. So you must honor God with your body. You getting the picture here? Nine times in this one verse, God's talking about who? Point to who he's talking about. Yourself. He's talking to you. He's not talking to the body of Christ yet. He's talking individually that you have to give your bodies to the Lord. Or else what? We drift. We drift. That's just what's going to happen. Romans 6, 12. Go there. Always want to support everything I say with some scripture so you can know that it's something you can bank on. Romans chapter 6, verses 12 and 13. You ready? Okay. Take your time, take your time. Okay. You ready? Listen to this. Do not let sin control the way you live. Do not give in to sinful desires. Do not let any part of your body become an instrument of evil to serve sin. Now, listen. I don't know if it's just because I'm bent and broken, but when I hear that, I think of certain parts. Come on now. Okay. And you got to get your mind off of just that. He's saying, don't let any part, okay, thumb, eye, ear, rear end, legs, like any part, right? How about the other stuff? How about your attention? How about your priority? All of you, anything that makes you up, okay? Don't let any part of that be used as an instrument of sin. Instead, give yourselves completely to God. For you were dead, but now you have new life. So use your whole body as an instrument to do what is right for the glory of God. Sin is no longer your master. Now, that's awesome, right? That sounds good, doesn't it? Come on now, help the preacher out, please. It does. It sounds good. It does sound good. I would like to, who would like to be that guy or that girl? 100% pure as the snow, right? All of us. But I would offer you this. As good as it sounds, and it does sound good, to me it sounds freaking brutally hard. I mean, completely. So now you're thinking about the one thing that you're doing wrong, probably. Shh. That there's something that we'd like to fix that we just can't seem to shake off, right? I want to get rid, but it's hard. It's very, very difficult. I mean, isn't it the whole room here, honestly, that would say that there's stuff that I shouldn't be doing that I'm doing, and the stuff that I should be doing that I'm not, right? Everyone in the room, everyone in the world could say that. That wouldn't be your original quote either. You couldn't put your name up there, because that's everybody. But you know, Paul the Apostle, the great guy, the guy who wrote half the New Testament, he said that in Romans chapter 7. I stole it from him. He said, the stuff I'm supposed to do, I can't do it. And the stuff I shouldn't be doing, I keep doing it. Help! Who can save me from this miserable life full of sin and death? He wrote half the Bible. Just shows you how hard it is. And what did he say? Who can help me? Jesus Christ, exclamation point. So that's a massive problem even for a guy like him. So what in the world, you got this massive task, what are you going to do? We're all guilty, right? Everyone wants to be this guy, that girl, but we can't. We got our thing, we keep going back to it. What in the world are we going to do? It's hard, God. So look what Paul says here. Go to the next book of the Bible, 1 Corinthians chapter 9, because he's screaming, yelling, I got a problem, I can't fix it, what am I going to do? He's like, I'm going to do something about it right here, right stinking now. I'm going to fix this problem. And we're all there, right? Anyone? Come on. I'm there. 1 Corinthians 9:27. I discipline my body like an athlete, training it to do what I should. Otherwise, I fear that after preaching, so he's a preacher. This guy's going around, history says he planted 14 churches. That's awesome, right? Wrote half the New Testament, planted 14 churches, going from city to city, appointing elders and leaders of these churches. He said, I train my body like an athlete, training it to do what it should. Otherwise, I fear that after preaching to others, I myself might be disqualified. Could I just venture to say that he says, if I don't do right, I may drift as well? Would you agree? When you think about an athlete, right? Does an athlete run on occasion? Does an athlete go to the gym once in a while? Do they eat right? Suck in your bellies now. Do they eat right? Sometimes? What do? How often do they exercise? All day, every day. How often do they, are they hammering down, I'm not ripping, I love that you did, but are they hammering down sausage and biscuits? I mean, like, are they doing that? That doesn't mean you should stop doing it. Praise the Lord. God is good. All the time God is good. God definitely, it says that all good things came down from the Father of lights. Biscuits and gravy. Boom. But they, listen, athletes, right, they do it all the time. Listen, what would happen? The extent of the surveys will tell us, like Barnahill, he'll tell us, George Barnahill, tell us that like 80% of Christians, they read their Bible once, and you know when it is? Yeah, it's not even then. It's what I say to you. That's your reading. What the preacher says to the people, that's their reading. That's crazy. So is the athlete the guy or the gal that works out an hour and a half a week and then goes to the Olympics and I'm going to win gold? Yeah, you're an idiot. Is it the one who stumbles upon it sometimes, eats good on occasion, or is it like diligent, working at it, all in for years? I'm going after this thing and I'm going to get it. That's what I'm going to do. The NIV says, Paul, in that same verse, he doesn't say disciplines like a body, like an athlete. He says, I strike a blow to my body that I might make it a slave. That's what it's like. Think of the taskmaster who whips the person into submission. You're going to do this thing. Wham, wham. And he forces. And that's what Paul says. It's so hard for me to be righteous and to live the way I should. So I'm going to strike my body with a blow. I'm going to make it be a slave. I'm going to put myself in an environment where God can build my faith so I will not drift. I can't make it happen, but I can put myself in front of my Bible. I can put myself into fellowship with other believers. I can put myself in church every week. I can do this and I will do it. That's what Paul says. He says, I'm a preacher and I drift. He's not just filling the pew. He's the preacher. And he has to be an evil taskmaster to himself. I will make myself pick up this word and I will study. Faith comes from hearing the word of God. And if you can't hear the word of God, you're just not going to have any faith. You can't just sit around and wait for it to fall out of heaven somewhere. So a lot of people do that. Living a life worthy of the gospel is tough, and it takes diligence. And it takes determination and attention and focus and effort. Big, big effort. It doesn't just fall upon you. So you need to work at this thing if you don't want to drift. You got to work at this thing. You got to beat your body into submission
physically submitting to what God would want for you so you could have all that he has for you. You're going to beat yourself into submission mentally. Things are going to come that are going to try to grab your attention away from God's word, away from communing with the saints to worship him and serve him. These things are going to come to you. They're coming, and you have to strike a blow to your body and say, listen, hell or high water, I'm going to study the word of God today. My soul needs this thing or I'm going to drift. I'm going to church tonight. No matter what happens, I'm going. Every single week. All the time. I'm not going to be ashamed. It's good to get together and to worship the King. It's good to get together and encourage one another when we're hurting. It's awesome. There's a privilege called the church. It's not an obligation. Do you know, I was reading the scripture this week. It's crazy. It says that God has been placed, God has placed all authority on Jesus for the benefit of the church. That's crazy. He did all this for us. It's a joy to come. It's a joy. So listen up. If you're one whom God delights in, and that means every single person in this room, you're not alone. You're not left alone to fend for yourself in this thing. You're not. It's hard to stand, and it's hard not to drift, but you're not alone. So this is awesome. I started praying and researching and stuff several weeks ago for this. And what I'm about to share with you was not even on the radar. This is so awesome. This is so awesome what I'm going to share with you. I'm not the smartest guy in the world. Who's not the smartest person in the world? Just raise your hand, right? No one's like Mr. Brilliant, right? Right. We're all just everyday Joes, right? So don't you love it when it's just, you know, it's not like Revelation where you're trying to like figure out, okay, what's the lamp and the sword coming out of his mouth? Like, what is that, right? Don't you love easy Bible stuff? Anyone? Or am I the only dum-dum? No one? I love easy stuff. Do you love easy stuff? So I'm stumbled upon this. I posted it online like I'd never read it or something. 2 Peter chapter 1, I was like, this is awesome! I couldn't believe what I found. So do me a favor, go there. Go to 2 Peter. Or you can just listen up. You can just listen up if you want. But go there. 2 Peter chapter 1, man, I found. And I'm like, whoa, this is awesome. Like, so that the thing that's on the table is how do we not drift, right? How do we not drift? Because I don't want to drift. No one wants to drift. I want to stay on it, right? So I don't want any guessing. And I don't want any theory. And I don't want any good ideas. I want to build on some rock. Amen? I want to build on some rock. So I'm reading this thing. I don't even know how I got to 2 Peter. I wasn't even on the radar for this thing, but I'm just going to give credit to the Lord because all good things come from him. So I go to 2 Peter and I'm start reading this thing and I'm like, what? So here's what I'm telling you. So the question is, how do we not drift? How do we not fall away, right? So look at 2 Peter 1, verse 10. And there's no details here, but just watch what it says. It says, doing this, you will never stumble or fall away. I'm like, what? There's something in there. There's a treat. Like, whoa, wait. Read on, though, because there's a reward. When you don't stumble, you don't fall away, you stick with it, right? It says, put some imagination when you're reading, right? Visualize this. If you don't fall away, and God will open wide the gates of heaven for you to enter into the eternal kingdom of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Can you see it? Can you see the red carpet for Jared? Jared, come on in, brother. Swing wide open the gates of heaven. Jared Scanlon's here. Woo! Can you imagine? I mean, just think about that for you. So I'm reading this. I'm like, whoa. What's the question you got to ask? Doing what? I want that right there is the answer. I don't want to drift. I want to stick with it. So there's got to be something there. So I want to read. So here it is. You ready? Got to go back. It says doing this, but what is doing what? Verse 3 of chapter 1. By his divine power, God has given us everything we need for living a godly life. He has called us to receive his own glory and goodness. And by the same power, he has given us all of his rich and wonderful promises. He has promised that you will escape the decadence all around you caused by evil desires, and that you will share in his divine nature. What? So now hold on a second before we read on. Don't just blaze through scripture, right? You gotta look at some of the wording in there. See, some of us, even right now, today, you've probably been praying, Lord, like, you got something going on in your life, and you're praying, like, Lord, give me the strength and the ability to do, and then you fill in the blank. Anyone? We're all get there, right? Listen, I have the best news ever. Quit praying that. Quit praying it. It says, by his divine power, he has given you, past tense, all that you need. That means everything to live a godly life. Stop praying for something that he already gave you. He already gave it to you. Everything you need to live a godly, what does it mean to live a godly life? Well, good news. Scripture's awesome. It tells us what it is. It says that you can share in his divine nature and to avoid the world's corruption, the decadence of the world by the flesh, i.e., could I offer this, the drift. We can avoid this. He's given you everything you need already to share in his divine nature and escape the corruption that puts you right there all the time. It's already been given. So what did God give us? Talks about here some precious promises. That's what he gave you, right? And there's lots of promises in scripture, isn't there? Matthew 6:33, if you seek me first, I'll give you everything you need. 1 John 1:9, if you confess your sin to me, I'm faithful to forgive you and to cleanse you of all unrighteousness. If you do, I will do. If you do, I will do. You see it all through the scripture. And even though those things are awesome, see that, those are great promises, but those are promises for you. But they pale in comparison to the promise he's gonna do to you. Let me tell you what that promise is. Luke 24. Three verses, real quick, just gonna come at you, I'm gonna read them. You can write it down, you can read it later. Luke 24:49. In red, Jesus speaking, and now I will send the Holy Spirit just as my Father promised. Acts 1:3. Acts 1:3. Jesus has gone to the cross, went to the grave. And during the 40 days after his crucifixion, he appeared to the apostles from time to time, and he proved to them in many ways that he was actually alive. And he talked to them about the kingdom of God. Now here we go. Here's the promise. Once when he was eating with them, he commanded them, do not leave Jerusalem until the Father sends you the gift he promised, as I told you before. John baptized with water, but in a few days you'll be baptized with the Holy Spirit. Galatians 3:14, proving it, getting to know God a little bit, right? Galatians chapter 3, verse 14 says this. Through Christ Jesus, through who? Anybody else? One and only, right? God has blessed the Gentiles with the same blessing he promised to Abraham, so that we who are believers might receive the promised Holy Spirit through faith. That is the greatest promise that has been delivered to the believer. I will be with you is no longer I'm hanging around kind of with you. No, that means I'm in you. Like, and we're always praying upward, like, to this far-off God up in heaven, right? Whoa, God, hear me. I'm way down here on earth. Can you hear me? Maybe it's time to turn our faces from here to here. He's right there with you, right? When does that, see, the people argue about this, though. Like, when does that happen? When does that happen? And people talk about that somehow you can be saved and you can make Jesus your Lord, and then later on somehow you get the Holy Ghost later. See? See, but Ephesians chapter 1, verse 13, I want you to go there and look at it so you don't think I'm just, because it's a contested thing. I want you to read it. Yeah, boy, there we go. All right. Ephesians 1, 13, it says, and now you Gentile, oh, you want to wait? Go ahead. I'll wait. I know. See? I'm going to wait as long as Jared needs for this one, brother. And go. Ephesians 1:13, pretty clear here. Watch this. And now you Gentiles, how many people in this room are Jewish other than me? Jewish, come on now, real Jews, 100%, right to the blood. Put your hand down, Jerome, you're lying in church. Frank is too, okay? There's only one Jew in this entire room, and you're all looking at him right now. So the rest of you are Gentiles, right? So this pertains to you, doesn't it? Okay, and now you Gentiles have also heard the truth. So someone told you the good news about Jesus along the lines. I don't know when it was, but you heard it. The good news that God saves you. And when you believed in Christ, he identified you as his own by giving you the Holy Spirit whom he promised long ago. Very clear, isn't it? I'm not making anything up. You all read it in your Bibles. When you believed, you got the Holy Spirit. 100%, he's there. Okay? So, you got this Holy Spirit. You've been given great promises in which to live a godly life. He says, do these things. Do these things, and you won't fall away. Do these things, and you won't slip up. You won't drift. You'll be fine. You'll stick with it. You're going to be fine. No worries. So go back to the scripture where we left off. What does it say? You share in his divine nature? How, God? What do I do? So make every effort. So there's some personal responsibility there, right? Make every effort to apply. Look, you don't have to work at this. It's not something you have to conjure up or get more of or whatever. He just says, make every effort to apply the benefits of these promises to your life. It's just like an insurance policy. You don't have to go out. If you have an insurance policy that covers your health, you don't have to go out and try to go fund me to raise millions of dollars for an operation that your insurance is going to cover already, right? So he says, listen, just apply the benefits. You've already been given it. It's already been given to you when you said yes, and he is now living inside of you. Apply the benefits of these promises to your life. Then your faith will produce, listen, it's not something you have to conjure up again. You gotta get this. Your faith will produce a life of moral excellence. A life of moral excellence leads to knowing God better. Knowing God leads to self-control. Self-control leads to patient endurance. And patient endurance leads to godliness. Godliness leads to love for other Christians, and finally, you will grow to have become to have genuine love for everyone. So, what's the only thing you really need to do? Go back to the beginning of that thing. The only thing, the beginning of the list is faith. So if faith comes from hearing the word of God, and all, if you have faith, then all these things, you lead into it. If you have faith, you'll lead to moral excellence. If you have moral excellence, it'll lead to knowing God better. So what do you got to do? The only thing you got to do to beat your body into submission is to make sure you make yourself get into an environment where the word of God is proclaimed over you and into you so your faith can grow. That's all you need to do. If you'll do that, He will do the rest. That's all you got to do. Just stick with it. That's all. It's so simple. We don't have to overcomplicate it. Look at the more you grow like this, the more you will become productive and useful in your knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. You know how many people are in jail, are back in rehab, divorced, crushed and ruined, that have a head full of knowledge about Jesus? Come on, right? We all know him. Quoting scripture, right? I mean, come on, right? Just sucking down weed and shooting up and all kinds of crap. And they're, I mean, listen, I'll tell you right now because she won't hide it. My wife, Meredith, she used to go to the bar and drinking, telling everyone about Jesus. No, she was drinking. No, not amen. She wasn't having a drink. She was drinking. But if we stick with it, right? Come on now. Get back with me. If we stick with it, and God's Holy Spirit's in you, and He's producing this stuff in you, then the more you become productive and useful in your knowledge of the Lord Jesus. But those who fail to develop in these virtues are blind, or at least very short-sighted. They have already forgotten that God has cleansed them from their old life of sin. He's saying, with that Holy Spirit inside of you, you don't need to go back to the junk again. You have the ability and the power to say no. You don't have to be the same person you were before. So how do we stay on track? How do we personally avoid the drift toward our former sinful patterns? How do we avoid falling away? By partnering with the promised Holy Spirit of God. Listen, who raised Christ from the dead and now lives in you. Does that blow anybody's mind? Like, that blows my mind. You know what else blows my mind? I'll tell you what, one thing. This is a side trick. I was reading the Bible today, and it says that now Christ ascended and He sits at the right hand of the Father in the heavenlies. Okay? If you're a Christian, you believe that? Okay, now listen to this. It also says in the scripture that if you're in Christ, you're seated with Him in the heavenlies. Doesn't that blow your mind? Like, wouldn't that, if the reality of that would sink down deep into your heart, wouldn't it change the way you look at your life? Wouldn't it change the way you look at each other? Wouldn't it change the way you work? Wouldn't it change the way you looked at people, acted towards people? Wouldn't it change that's a game changer. You personally, if you're a believer in Christ, you are seated by the right hand of the Almighty in heaven right now. That's power, right? That's power. That's power. Blows my mind. So we stay on track by partnering with the promised Holy Spirit who raised Jesus from the dead. Now He lives in me. We work with Him to bring about personal holiness created by diligent and personal effort and attention to pursuing faith. That's what we do. And when we pursue faith, we acquire biblical knowledge that's useful. And we allow God to grow patience and self-control in us and practicing. We need to practice genuine love, not just to those that we like, and not just with words, but genuinely loving people. Do you know what genuinely loving people means? That means that when you see, when you sense a hunger in your belly, what do you do? Okay, so There's people that have hunger in their bellies. That's how you love them. You don't pray for them, you feed them. And you pray with them. Come on now, right? So I want to close here and say that if you work hand in hand with the Holy Spirit, with a daily, I need this, I want this in my life. I want to stay on it. I don't want to drift. I want to apply all the benefits thereof of receiving the Creator of heaven and earth inside of me. He's no longer just dwelling over the nothingness before creation. He now lives inside of you. And listen, if you have that attitude and you have that effort to work at this, here's the promise of God. The promise of God is if you stick with this thing and you pursue me earnestly, you will never drift. You will never, ever drift. Do you hear me? It says it. And we need to stop living life on what you see and start living life on what you read. That's the truth. If you stick with this thing, he says, do these things and you will not fall away. And I will swing open the gates of heaven and welcome you in. And if you bring that to the table, you healthy like that to the table, you can be a healthy part of a very healthy whole. So it starts with me. Raise your hand right here. Not me, all of us. But listen, but it eventually it transitions, of course, to the we, which is where this message series gets its title, A Healthy Body. And it's right there where we'll pick up next week. Amen? Let's pray. Father, I thank you for the truth of God's word. I thank you for the precious promises that are all throughout Scripture waiting to be dug out and mined by the believer. How awesome it is, Lord, when you promise something in Scripture and we live it out and we see it happen right before our very eyes in our own lives. And it's in those moments that you build our faith. You also said that you will build our faith where we hear the word of God. So here's the thing, Lord. I'm gonna ask you something. You in your word, you said that if us fathers who are sinful know how to give good gifts, how much more so would our perfect Heavenly Father give good gifts to those who ask? And so this is what I'm asking you to do, to gift everyone in this room right now an amazing filling of your Spirit. And if you're with me, say amen. Okay, fill us with your Spirit so that we could apply all the benefits of receiving your Spirit inside of us. That we would desire to spend time with you. That we would desire to serve you. That we would desire to give to your kingdom. We would desire to pray. We would desire to spend time in your word. We would desire to meditate on it. But Lord, at the same time, we need your help because it's not easy to want those things. And to do those things. We want them, but we struggle. And so we appreciate the honesty and the gut-wrenching truth of Paul, who says, I strike a blow to my body, making it be a slave. So Lord, I pray that you would help us by the power of your Spirit that raised Christ from the dead. You'd give us the ability to strike a blow to our body, to make us listen to your prompting when we hear the call of your Spirit, say, come to me, spend time with me. To say yes to you and no to everything else. We need your Spirit to help us with that. Lord, also apply the benefit of exciting our spirit as we serve you. Yes, Lord, help us. Invigorate our spirit once again afresh for this year. We thank you, Lord. I ask your blessing on every single person in this church that can hear me right now. And Lord, if there is someone in this church that has never said yes to the free gift of God for all eternity, to take every single nasty, wretched, ugly, stinky, sewer-ridden sin and throw it into the depths of the ocean because your son Jesus died on the cross for that person. I pray, Lord God, that you would help that person to say yes to you right now. All Christians pray for that person. And if there's a person here that wants to say yes and has been confused by other preachers and other churches that said you got to do this and you got to do that, let me encourage you with God's word. The Bible says that if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is your Lord and you believe that Christ was raised from the dead, you will be saved. And so if that is you and you want to cut through all the red tape of church junk and accept Jesus and be part of his family forever, you come up and talk to me. We'll pray together and we'll love on each other and we'll love on the Lord and let him love on you. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Now let's sing to the Lord. Thank you.